What is up, guys? Welcome to Real Talk, the unedited, scripted, unfiltered show where I sit down with a gaming personality and talk about anything and everything. Today's a special show for a couple of reasons. Here, let's go ahead and bring me up on the shot. It's our first live show ever. So if you guys are watching on Twitch TV, hello and welcome. We'll be doing subscriber-only chat for the foreseeable future and also subscriber questions towards the end of the show. But since it's a live show, I'm sure some stuff will happen that we don't have any control over, so just kind of roll with us as I learn as I go along here. So regardless, let's jump to today's guest. So for many, today's guest is the reason that they got into competitive StarCraft. During the beta, a Husky and HD StarCraft created one of the biggest tournaments, the HDH Invitational. Fast forward to today, and Husky is one of the most important gateways into the scene, an immensely popular caster, and a driving force behind the presence of competitive StarCraft II on YouTube. Mike, welcome to Real Talk, man.
Oh, JP, you are way too kind in your intros. I don't know if you're that flattering to everyone, but no, seriously, thank you so much for having me. And heads up, if my computer dies, I've been trying to fix it for months now. And I'm kicking it out the door after this month is over. So hopefully everything works, and I don't look like a total idiot, but we'll see.
Yeah. Well, I got a first question for you, and it's something that I've been wondering for quite a long time. Where in the world did H to the Husky Husky come from, and why do you still use it to this day?
Okay, so back when I first started on YouTube, I had another account where I actually did Brood War commentaries, and that was way before StarCraft II was even announced. No one knew when or where or what the game was going to look like at all, and that's when I very first started. And the thing about at least YouTube is that you need some sort of intro and some sort of outro. If you watch anyone on YouTube, they don't just start talking. They don't just start vlogging. They either have some sort of intro, whether it's a song, a sang, or whatever, and some sort of outro. And the ones I were coming up with, man, they were just atrocious.
Well, hold on. So this is better than all the other ones?
Yeah, no, I know. That's the offensive thing, is that there was even worse intros than the one I use now. And then, so I was just, like, stressing about it. I'm like, I'm coming off as a douchebag. And so anyway, someone left a comment on my channel that said it was just H and then the little, what's the little pointy thing that points upwards? You use it in math all the time if you're typing. Anyways, it was H and then that and then Husky. And he was like, it's H to the Husky Husky. It was just a random comment, like, 4 years ago. Or 3 years ago or something, and ever since then I've used it just because I find it hilarious, and I know a lot of people absolutely hate it, and I've probably lost millions of subscribers over it, but that's okay. You gotta have some sort of intro. It's just how the game's played, man.
Have you ever thought about maybe doing like a musical intro? I mean, you do a lot of your Nerd Alert songs. Have you ever thought about going that route, or have you done it
totally
for so long now that you've stuck to H to the Husky Husky?
Totally. I think at this point it's reached critical mass where I can't change it, but for a little while I had Kurt make up a little intro, and it ended up sounding like it was just really bad. I don't know if anyone remembers that. I only put it on two videos and everyone made fun of it, and so I didn't use that anymore. I did have a little jingle made by Kurt, but it was extra editing and I didn't like it nearly as much. So I think it's here to stay, even if a lot of people are upset about it.
All right. Well, we're going to get to all of your YouTube, your StarCraft II, your esports career. But first, I want to talk about growing up as Mike Lamon. So where did you grow up, Mike?
So I was born in California. I was technically born in Bakersfield, which, I mean, hardly anyone's happy to be from Bakersfield, man. But I was technically born there. And then since the pollution there is so bad, right when I was born, my parents were like, well, we aren't raising a kid here. So we moved to a place called Nipomo. It's on the coast. It's right by Pismo Beach in California. And it was when they moved there, no one actually lived there. It's a big town or city or whatever now. But as a kid, it wasn't that way. And so I lived there from 1 until 11, 10 and a half, something like that. Uh-huh. And then we ended up moving to Oregon just because my parents were able to get really good work there. And so we ended up moving to Oregon. And I lived in Oregon from 11 to 22. So it was exactly like half. And then I ended up moving back to, L.A. now. And so I've been living in L.A. for about 2 years, a little over 2 years, I think, or almost 2 years now. September 20th will be 2 years. So, yeah, almost exactly a month away. So that's where I grew up. And, yeah, so I guess I'm half Californian, half Oregonian. But I feel more Oregonian But California has started to grow on me a little bit. I didn't think it would, but the cool thing about California is that everyone, at least in LA, I feel like no one's from LA. Everyone moves from around the world to move to LA to work on really cool stuff. So
yeah, yeah.
Well, once I realized that, I was like, all right, LA's not as bad as I made it out to be, but drivers are still crazy here, man.
They are. They are. What did your parents do for work when you were growing up?
So my dad did HVAC, which is just heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. And I also have a brother, so my mom raised both of us, and she worked up until we were born and then basically did that full-time. And so my dad worked, full-time in a big old union doing the HVAC stuff. And he also did – I can't remember what he did when I was like 11, but he apparently worked – somewhere cool, like some nuclear reactor or something totally random. I don't remember what it was, but I was like, that's kind of badass. But that was when we lived in California, and then yeah, we moved up to Oregon. Apparently people need to be warm in Oregon, so there's a lot of work installing heaters, so that's what he did.
Do you have any siblings?
Yeah, I have the one brother. He is an older brother, and he went more the route of kind of what my dad does. He's a professional plumber, which apparently they get paid boku bucks. Holy God. I did not realize how much money you make as a plumber, man. So they're up there plumbing and heating and ventilating all the Northwest. So good job on them.
I got to ask, your parents or your father and your brother, it seems like everyone in your family worked normal jobs. When you told them that you were going to be moving down to LA to become a full-time YouTuber, what were their thoughts about that?
Yeah, it's kind of cool. I think taking it back a little bit further than that, when I was in college, I went to a community college for 3 or 4 years trying to figure out what I wanted to do. I got my transfer degree and all that, which is a thing in Oregon where you can go to any university after you get your transfer degree. So I was still trying to figure out exactly what I wanted to do. At first, I wanted to be like a nurse, and that was like, well, that's a lot of work. So I wanted to be a veterinarian, not realizing that that's even more work. So I always liked kind of medical stuff, helping out, whether it's people or animals. I really like that. But I definitely struggled with the math aspect of that, just because I'm so terrible at math, man. But so I slowly started getting into more computer-oriented stuff, everything other than programming. So anything hardware or support or IT or any stuff like that. That's what I was like, networking, developing and all that, but not the software side, because I'm even worse at programming because it's all math. So anything with math wasn't good for me. But I had always spent so much time on the computer throughout my entire life. We got our first computer when I was 11, and my parents were really skeptical about getting me a computer, but my God, I'm so glad that they did. And so I had always played games, and then when I was in college, I kind of started watching StarCraft a little bit and started doing YouTube. I eventually ended up moving back to my parents' house because I tried going to U of O for a couple of terms, and I didn't really like the whole university vibe. I kind of felt – I don't necessarily want to say over it, but I felt like I was paying to be put in – I just don't like the university lifestyle, like hanging out with the bros and sharing a dorm with a bunch of people and stuff like that. I felt like I was kind of past that, and I really wanted to get – kind of jump-started on the stuff I wanted to do. So one of the things I was doing was my YouTube channel, and when I moved back to my parents' house, I was like, all right, so this whole university thing, it didn't work out. But
did they take that?
But I have a YouTube channel with 800 subscribers, so do you still love me? And it was actually pretty funny because at that point, I was paying for college on my own. It was through my own income, and I had some student loans and all that. So I was doing that, and so when I dropped out, I guess you could call it, they were very, very supportive. They knew I wasn't some deadbeat who was just going to take to a life of alcoholism or anything. So they knew that I was going to find my way. So they were actually surprisingly supportive. I say surprisingly because at the time, I was making no money doing anything at all. I was just having a lot of fun making videos. At one point, I was making 100 videos a month, so I don't know the math on that, but
Jesus.
That's a lot of videos, and that's what I was doing. And I'll be honest, if you're making 100 videos a month, it makes it difficult to do the school thing. So that definitely attributed to it, but they were super supportive, like a lot more than I would ever expect. And then as time went on and the opportunity to actually move to LA to do what I wanted for a living – as soon as I was presented, they were just like, why are you talking to us? Why are you not in LA right now? So they definitely pushed to do basically what I wanted to do. And they didn't necessarily understand YouTube. I didn't even understand YouTube at that time because I wasn't making money at all. I didn't know it was a viable thing, but I knew it was something that I loved to do. The people I was going to move down to work with were super supportive. Like, they knew it was going to take me a while to get on my feet. And everything just kind of came all together because everyone was super supportive. And I was able to thankfully make it work. I'm not living on the street right now, so that's good.
I want to roll back just a little bit. Your academic career, in terms of the cliques that you kind of hung out with, you said you weren't a fan of the jocks in college. Were you lord of the nerds back in high school and whatnot?
I mean, it's such an interesting thing because in my high school, the high school I went to, if any of you know Dodger, press start to continue, we went to the same high school, and I think we always kind of talk about it the same way in that it was a much smaller high school. It was kind of in rural Oregon. It was only like 800 people total, which apparently people go to high schools that are like thousands of people. So ours was really, really small, and at least my graduating class, like for the most part, were actually all pretty cool. Like, we had a football team that blew because we were such a tiny school. So, like, that was never prevalent. We had, like, a tennis team and a swimming team. And I feel like no one joins the tennis team and is like, nerd, while they're playing tennis. So everyone was, like, pretty cool. And my whole thing was, in middle school, I was, like, the super nerd. I was the socially awkward, crazy super nerd that I think we've all been there at least once. And so I was the guy on the bus playing Pokemon Blue and just, like, wearing atrocious clothes and all of that. And and people did pick on me in middle school. But in high school, freshman year, I just was like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm not going to put up with this bullshit anymore. And so anytime anyone would make fun of me at all in any way, I would just make fun of myself even more. And I remember, like, the bully who picked on me in middle school. When we went to high school, he was just so confused as to how someone could be so self-deprecating. And so at least for me in the smaller school, that ended up working out great. And everyone kind of left me alone. And then I became kind of like the cool nerd where it's like you can't actually piss Mike off. And so I kind of want to say I was my own clique because I would hang out in the library during lunch. Like, how dweeby is that? I would hang out in the library during lunch, eat my lunch in there, and I would play Magic the Gathering with my friends. Like, I mean, that's as dweeby as it gets when it comes to high school. So I was in the library playing Magic the Gathering, and it was just me and one other friend. And then as time went on, like, everyone started hanging out in the library and playing Magic, and I'm like, what the hell is this? Like, I can't even play Magic in peace. So instead of hanging out in the library, I started hanging out in the computer lab. And our computer lab was pretty janky, let me tell you. The only thing we could get to work on the computers was StarCraft 1, and that has such low system specs. So I started hanging out in the computer lab during lunch and playing StarCraft with my one friend again. And then everyone started hanging out there and playing StarCraft. And then they got us all in trouble because they installed Counter-Strike. So I got kicked out of the computer room. So I was like, all right, I've got the perfect plan. No one else is going to follow me. It's going to be great. I started hanging out in the most hated English teacher in our entire school. She was a teacher in middle school, and then when we all graduated high school, she was like, I just love these kids so much, I'm going to follow them to high school. And she was the most hated and strict and harsh teacher in the world. So I'm like, I'm going to hang out there. No one's going to follow us, and they all did. So I don't know what clique I joined, but whoever the big group of people was who liked playing Magic in English class during lunch is, I guess, my clique. And then in high school, I mostly just kept my really close friends, and I've always had a ton of online friends because I've played so many online games. So I never, like, stayed after school to play sports or anything. It was always rush home, play StarCraft, play Counter-Strike, and Diablo 2. And that was pretty much all of high school and then leading into college.
Outside of video games, you mentioned you played Magic the Gathering. Did you play any other type of games or have any other types of hobbies?
I mean, that's not really. I mean, I played Magic, like, at school, and then literally when I got home, even when I was a little kid, I would always play. Our first console was the NES, and then we had the Super Nintendo, N64, GameCube, and then that's when we finally got a computer. But, yeah, I'm trying to remember high school. Like, all I mostly did was rush home and play a lot of D-Dust on Counter-Strike. I also did play a lot of StarCraft as well. And then most of the time when I did hang out with friends, it was them bringing their computers over because there's this thing called LAN that we had. It's ancient technology. It's long forgotten by now. But we would hook up our computers all the time, and we played a lot of Counter-Strike and a ton of StarCraft, and that was a hangout at Mike's house, like, every weekend. So that's mostly what I did during high school.
Do you remember who introduced you to gaming and video games in general?
Hmm.
Or how you were
Well,
introduced to it?
yeah, I mean, it's been so long. The very first console I had was the NES, and then I know my dad before that had some old Atari system. I can't remember what it was, because that was when I was like a little kid. And then my grandmother got us the NES when it was like the cool thing to have. And my parents, they tell me this all the time. They were super reluctant because gaming wasn't really a thing back then. I mean, it kind of was coming up, but the parents at that time really didn't know much about it. But yeah, my grandma got me the NES, and then ever since then, I've just been addicted. I mean, I used to play, like, of course, Super Mario, Excitebike, and stuff like that. And then once I turned, I want to say, like, 10 or 11, maybe 10 is when I was introduced to my first LAN party. And it was introduced to me by my cousins, who are actually still living in Bakersfield. And they took us to a LAN party, and we played one of the original Quakes multiplayer. It was the Quake where you had the grappling hook. I forget which one that is,
Quake
but
2,
it
I
was.
believe.
I think it was Quake 2, and I just remember I was 10 years old, and all I would do is grappling hook people and just follow them around, and I was terrible, of course. We also played Mech Warrior, which was just so badass, and then also Warcraft 2. And so I just have such fond memories of being 10 years old and playing those games at the LAN parties, and just thinking, like, these guys are really cool. Like, they're actually really cool guys. They went on to do super nerdy jobs, and I wouldn't be surprised to see them, like, well, being the first people landing on Mars, man. They have pretty nerdy jobs. And so, yeah, that was my first introduction to competitive gaming as well as LAN parties. And despite what anyone says ever, there's nothing like a LAN party. It is amazing. So if you're in high school or a college or whatever, have a LAN party because they're awesome.
Absolutely. It seems like everyone that plays the Warcraft series, Warcraft 1 and 2, kind of was a gateway game into the into StarCraft. Was it the same case for you?
Sort of. I want to say, I'm trying to remember because I played so many games. I think my first major RTS was the original Command and Conquer. I can't remember if I played a lot of Warcraft 2 before that, but either way, I did play both of those. And then I remember when I was playing Command and Conquer, like, it was super fun. The campaign is great. I was terrible, of course, because I was like 10 or something. But and then my friend had StarCraft, so I went to go hang out at his house, and this is like right when StarCraft came out. And I was like 10 or 11, and I just remember watching it and being completely mesmerized, just because it had a completely different look than Command and Conquer. The units acted completely differently. The whole feeling of it was completely different. And then I was kind of a diehard 11-year-old Command and Conquer fan, and then I eventually picked up StarCraft once I beat Command and Conquer in and out. And so I got the game about 6 months after it came out, and I kind of never really looked back after that. So I would say Command & Conquer is probably my biggest gateway RTS game, but I played so many games before that.
Now, I was doing some research before this, and I read that you started casting, so to speak, for your college roommates. Is that correct?
Yeah, so when I was living in Eugene, going to U of O, University of Oregon, I had three roommates who were all super nerdy guys. We went to high school together and college together, and we all decided to move at the same time to go to college at U of O. And so that is when I first discovered competitive StarCraft. So I was probably like 21, 22, something like that. And that was my first exposure to competitive StarCraft with GOM TV. That was when Tasteless cast completely by himself. Oh, excuse me. He cast completely by himself at super wacky hours. It was like 3 a.m. or something is when it started, and it would end at like 6 a.m. or just something atrocious. And that was back again when Brood War was out. StarCraft II, I don't think, was even announced by then. And my college roommates, like, for about 3 weeks, we would all stay up, and I want to say it was on like a Sunday or during the week or something. We would all stay up and watch it, and then they started dropping off because they're like, "I'm not gonna watch StarCraft at 6 in the morning when I have to go to college at 8 in the morning. Like, you're a great guy, Husky, but no, we're not going to be doing it." So I continued watching it, and then my friends would ask me, like, "Oh, how did Bisou do, or how did Jadong do?" Because they kind of knew, like, the main stars there, because they had watched a couple weeks of it. And so I was just like, you know what, I'm just going to show them. So what I would do is anything that was not English casted already by Tasteless, so anything that was on GOM TV, I never cast, but anything on like the OSL and the MSL, which were the original tournaments, I would cast that for them and be like, here you go, enjoy this. And I would put it on YouTube so they could watch it, like, between classes or during classes or whatever. And eventually, you know, it started. Other people started finding it is when that all started. But initially, yeah, I mean, my only fans were my couple of roommates, and that's kind of how it originally started.
Now, I want to kind of switch focus to StarCraft II. When the game was announced and then finally the beta came out, did you kind of have a plan for what you were going to do at incremental stages throughout the beta, or were you just kind of doing content as it came to you?
I mean, it's kind of a mix of both. I don't want to say I'm some super genius or anything like that. When I started my channel, StarCraft II was non-existent. I mean, Blizzard had started it, obviously, because they'd been working out for so long, but it wasn't made public at all. And so when I started my channel, I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to cast StarCraft II when it comes out. It was just, I want to cast StarCraft I, because that's been my favorite game for like a decade. But when they did announce StarCraft II, I knew that, you know, everyone who had been playing StarCraft I, I mean, because everyone, I feel like everyone has at least had some experience with StarCraft I, because you either played it once as a kid, you played it once as an adult when it came out, or something. So all those people within the next decade, or the past decade, who had played it, I had a feeling were at least going to come back to check StarCraft II once it was announced. Because I've never met anyone who's like, I hate StarCraft. Like, it's a terrible game. I mean, that's just something that no one says, no matter what games they're actually into. And so once they finally announced it, and I kind of saw it, and I was like, okay, I don't think Blizzard's going to mess this game up. When the game drops, I'm super excited about it. I'm going to be playing it as much as possible. And I had a feeling that other people were going to be excited about it as well. And so really my only plan, quote-unquote, when it finally dropped in the beta was to just play as much as I could, and realizing that if I'm excited about this, there's a damn good chance that other people are excited too. So that's when I started sharing the content basically as soon as I could. So it did end up working out. I mean, obviously a lot of people wanted to see it, and a lot of people still follow it today. But yeah, so that was my plan, was just I'm excited, so hopefully other people are excited too.
Now, one of the biggest things in the beta was the HDH Invitational. How did you and HD kind of meet, I guess, and how did this really come to fruition? Where did the idea come from? Who kind of took the biggest leaps getting it prepared and all that? And what roles did you guys have as well for the tournament?
Yeah, totally. So me and HD, we met basically, it was kind of interesting because when we started our initial channels, we both were doing Brood War. And at that time, there was maybe 10 StarCraft casters that were known. So, I mean, there's Moltrap, Klazart, Cholera, all that. So there was casters that were already established in the StarCraft community. And we were way late to the bandwagon or boat or whatever you want to call it. We started many years after they had already started. And so we actually, by complete coincidence, no connection, never knowing each other, we started our YouTube channels within like 2 or 3 days of each other doing Brood War. And I want to say that HD contacted me first. I'm trying to remember because it was many years ago at this point. And he was just kind of like, look, we're the underdogs. No one knows us, but we have the same passion for StarCraft. We started StarCraft commentaries almost at the exact same day. Completely unrelated, and so that's kind of how we met. And then ever since then, we did like dual casts and things like that. Still trying to figure out like, hey, what's a good way of recording it? What settings are you using? How often are you uploading? What's your casting style? So we definitely vibed off each other, cross-emoted a lot, and all that. And then once the beta came out, we were very blessed to have iRip, the guy Matt, who actually sponsors Team Liquid right now, the Little App Factory. That was his first endeavor into esports, and Matt was an awesome guy. He contacted us right when the beta was starting and was like, hey, I want to give you guys $1,000 to make a tournament and just run with it and do whatever you want. And so when I do stuff, I really like to be extremely hands-on and very, like, you know, doing the scheduling, doing the contacting everyone, setting up the brackets, setting up the maps and all that. So I was definitely very hands-on when it came to that tournament. And then when he said, here's $1,000, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to sit back and watch because I'm a big fan. And if it works, it works. If not, then whatever, it's $1,000 and we move on. And those are the kind of people that I work really, really well with, are the kind of people who just give me something to run with and are like, if it works out, it does. If it doesn't, oh well. And those are the people I really try to impress. It's not the people who are like, well, I'll give you $1,000, but you have to guarantee that I'm going to get yada, yada, yada. Those are the people I tend not to work with. And so Matt just basically was like, here's the money, man. And so that got me really excited because back then, I mean, there was no, I don't think there was a single StarCraft tournament at that point, because everyone was still figuring out, is it going to be a good game? They're all just playing the game as opposed to, like, doing anything else at all. So it was definitely tough to have to sit back and be like, all right, I'm going to make a tournament even though I really want to play this new game. So it was a big thanks to Matt for the Little App Factory. He's the one who sponsored it. And then I was just very, very hands-on trying to get everything done, because there was no formula for doing it now. I mean, if you watch the production value on that and compare it to the $75 dailies, like, theirs are way better now. And so back then, it was kind of like a trailblazing thing, I guess, where we were just trying to fumble around and figure it out. Our scheduling was horrible. We didn't know, like, what servers people were supposed to play on. So that tournament, we just made everyone, if they agreed to play in the tournament, everyone had to play on the American server. Which, if you do that now, it's like blasphemy, and, like, you know, everyone would complain about it. But back then, we had no idea what you were supposed to do, like, because it was the first time a game had ever been, I wouldn't call it segregated, but had been on different servers, whereas Brood War was not quite like that. So yeah, we just kind of fumbled our way through it, and I mean, thankfully it worked out. The tournament did great. I think it got a lot of people excited. Every time I see posts on the internet, a lot of them are always about, you know, the HGH Invitational is what got me into it. I've been following it ever since, and so I mean, I couldn't have asked for more from that tournament. Looking back on it now, I can kind of laugh at, like, the casting and the production, and, you know, even the play by the players. But at the same time, I mean, 2 years ago, we had no idea what we were doing. So that's how that got started, and kind of where it led us to now.
What was the hardest thing about the tournament, in your eyes?
Definitely trying to figure out how to get a hold of the players was a total pain in the ass. Because, number one, like, the game hadn't been out for that long. And number two, like, a lot of these players, they had no public way of getting in touch with them. They may not have even had Twitter back then. And so trying to get in touch with the players and trying to be like, okay, this is the time zone. You have to play on the American server at this time. Play these games. This is the map pool. Blah, blah. So trying to coordinate with the players to make it work for everyone, that, I think, was definitely the hardest part. Some of the games were so epic. I just remember some amazing times. Like, the finals was just ridiculous. There was a lot of nukes used. I think it was, like, Nazgul versus TLO or something. Anyways, it came out. The games themselves were great, so casting it was no problem. But setting up a tournament, I mean, it's so much work doing something like that it's almost unbelievable. Like, you think it's easy, but when you are, number one, casting it, number two, running a YouTube channel, and number three, trying to set everything up, it's a miracle that tournament ever actually finished.
If you could do it all again, what would you change? What was like the number one thing that you wish, after it was all over and done with, that you could have come back and changed?
Definitely the scheduling. That's something that I've had an issue with really my entire life, and it's something that I really struggle with, is laying out a strict schedule and actually sticking to it. And that always bugged me, where I'm even having issues with this now with, like, my Nerd Alert music videos and stuff, is that, you know, you set a deadline, and then what do you do if those deadlines aren't reached, and trying to deal with that. If I was to do, say, another HGH Invitational or something that is large scale like that, I think the important thing is, in today's StarCraft world, which is a million times different than it was back then, is trying to make a tournament stand out in some way. So just getting pro players playing 1v1 games, that is not enough to run a successful tournament anymore, because I feel like there's so many tournaments now that what we did with the HGH 2 years ago, that's not going to work in today's world. So I would definitely try and find a way to make it very interesting, very unique, doing things like maybe like a 2v2 tournament, or just finding some way to make it stand out. And that's kind of what me and Day 9, I feel like, accomplished when we did the GSPA, which was probably my next big tournament that I was heavily involved with, because what we did on that one is it was a completely open tournament with pretty good prizes. And so we had something like, I'm trying to remember how many thousands, it was like 3,000 or 4,000 people sign up. And so to me, that was something that hadn't been done very efficiently, at least on YouTube at that point. So if I was to do another tournament that I'm getting my fingers into, I would try and find another way to, I guess, step it up to make it more interactive, more interesting, and more engaging.
Now, you and HD went on to do some more projects together. One of them was StarCraftArena.net. Currently, the site is inactive. What happened with the site, and is there any plans to do something like that again in the future?
So with everything I've done ever, I mean, there's no playbook on how to do anything. It has been the most crazy learning experience of my life. And so one example is StarCraftArena.net that we co-launched together like a year ago or something like that. I can't remember exactly how long ago it was. But what we learned with that is that if you go into making any kind of website, you have got to have a staff behind it. Unless, like, if we were just running a website, we could have totally done it right, I think, and we could have made an awesome website. But the problem was that we were both running YouTube channels, and like I said, I was making 100 videos a month right at the beginning of beta as well as before that. And so trying to juggle running a website that had a ton of traffic to it with forums and trying to moderate that as well as run the YouTube channels, I mean, we definitely got in way over our heads. There's really no other way to explain it. And that was probably one of the best learning experiences I almost want to say of my life, is that you can get really excited about a project, you can have a lot of support for it, but if you don't go into it completely prepared, it's going to crush you. I have mad respect for Team Liquid, for example, because they have an extremely heavily trafficked website and they have hundreds of moderators who are helping them run it. So we were attempting to do something comparable only by ourselves, which, looking back, I mean, hindsight's 20/20, man, that was a terrible mistake. And then ever since then, I've realized that if I want to do a website, I'm going to have to either get a full team behind it or I'm going to have to dedicate a ton of time to doing it right. And it eventually got to where it was just too much. We were traveling too much. We were doing too much, and it just unfortunately didn't work out. But at the same time, I feel like I learned so much from that. So apologies to anyone who is a fan of the website, but it's definitely, if nothing else, I'll take full responsibility because I got in way, way over my head.
Now, the number one question that I think you have probably been asked ever since the HDH Invitational, you guys announced the second one. I believe you stated that you had prize money for it and everything was ready to go. And then it never happened. You stated in one of your vlogs on your YouTube channel that after the first MLG, you and HD kind of started going and doing your own thing. Was there a reason for this? And did you purposely distance yourself from HD for any reason? Or was it just simply you guys wanted to do your own thing after working together for so long?
As much as everyone wants there to be some crazy backstory about how I slept with HD's mom, I stole his car and wrecked it and stole the rims and all that, there's no malicious intent there at all. So really, what happened was the sponsor wanted us to, Matt, he wanted us to sponsor his new upcoming product, which was iRip. And he had just launched the product at that point. He wanted it to be sponsored by iRip, basically, is what he wanted it to be. And so he was like, well, the first tournament was great. I mean, we should definitely do another tournament. And we got really, really excited about it, and we were just coming off the high, I guess, of finishing the first tournament. And so, again, one of the problems I have is proper prior planning. And so this is something that I still struggle with today, is that we got really excited about it and then realized, well, number one, everyone is already making crazy, awesome tournaments. I mean, like MLG, they threw StarCraft in basically at the drop of a hat because they plan out their entire year, and then StarCraft II all of a sudden came out and they were like, well, crap, we got to throw this in here. So they had the production value of MLG. There's a lot of other tournaments starting to pop up now. And again, it got to the point where I didn't feel like it was going to bring anything extra at that stage. And then also, again, my YouTube channel was doing very well. It was still peaking out from the excitement of StarCraft II. So it's one of those things where, again, I think we got a little in over our heads. And me personally, I really like to do things right when I do them. That's why there's only, for example, 4 Nerd Alert songs. I could release a bunch of horrible ones that I film with the flip cam, but when I do something like that, like a big project that I'm really going to be known for a long time, I like to do it right. Now, unfortunately, I'm kind of known for making a promise and breaking it, which does suck. But at that point, I mean, I had just begun focusing on my YouTube a lot more and doing, trying to gear up for other stuff. Plus, the other tournaments had already kind of stepped up their game a lot. So it didn't end up working out, but thankfully the sponsor, the Little App Factory, I remember having a very specific discussion with him where I was like, look, I don't know if this is going to work out. And he was like, well, what do you think about Team Liquid? Do you think I should sponsor them? I don't know too much about them, but they seem like they're kind of the shit. And so I remember that conversation. I was just like, you should absolutely 100% sponsor Team Liquid. They have their shit together way beyond what I'm going to have at any time soon, because I was still learning how to kind of basically motivate myself in the right ways to get stuff done correctly. And so that was when he decided to go ahead and sponsor Team Liquid as well. So even though the tournament never happened, at least me personally, I always felt really great that he was able to find a sponsor, that Team Liquid was able to find a sponsor, and also that Matt from the Little Laugh Factory was able to find someone that he would be excited to sponsor as well. So that aspect of it ended up working out. It's not like the money was like given to me and I just ran away to Tahiti with it. I never got money for the second tournament because it never happened. And instead what he did is start to invest more money into Team Liquid, and that's how that relationship kind of developed.
Gotcha. All right, well, let's talk about your YouTube. Take me back, however long ago it was, 3 or 4 years now, to what made you start your YouTube channel? And also, how did you kind of hear about it? Did you think that you were just going to be posting videos and getting money for it?
Okay, never in 800 million years would I ever think that I was going to make a penny doing YouTube. Because especially back then when I started, YouTube was... I wouldn't say it's a barren wasteland, but it was kind of like the Wild West. Like, no one really knew exactly what was going on. There was a lot of bots going on and a lot of spam-type stuff happening. And gamers could not at all make money in any way. There was no partnership program for gamers or anything like that. And we'll talk, I would imagine, about that later. But when I started making videos, I knew YouTube. I'd watched my fair share of cute cat videos and talking dogs and all that. The thing is that I did some early research, and YouTube was by far the best platform for uploading any sort of video file. They may not have the best quality, they may not have the best video player, they may not have the best setup when it comes to finding videos and all that, but they are hands down the best free-to-use service out there, bar none, no one compares. And if you want to upload your own videos, you're going to pay like $20,000 a month to host your own 1080p videos. So that's why I started uploading to YouTube. The main reason that I got into YouTube again was because Tasteless, I mean, that poor guy was working, busting his ass, casting nonstop tournaments by himself, and I just felt like there wasn't as much StarCraft English content as there should be. So I was just like, well, I'm going to go ahead and start this. If one person watches it and likes my stuff, then that's awesome. And if no one watches it, then I'm going to show it to my mom and she'll watch it. So I never had any big... grand, glorious, I'm going to be the king of the internet or anything like that when I started. And really, I mean, it took over a year to make a penny off doing my YouTube. Before I made any money at all, I had over 900 videos. And so that was a full-time job, especially with my parents' internet, which was atrocious. It took like 8 hours to upload one video. So I don't even know how the math works out on that. But I somehow managed to get 900 videos in a year. And I wasn't getting paid for it. It wasn't going anywhere fast. I was getting maybe like a couple hundred, 800 views maybe per video. But I love StarCraft so freaking much that I just kept doing it and kept doing it and kept doing it. And so I guess, you know, Tasteless, again, was my first intro to professional casting. And I thought it was such a cool thing that I just decided, hey, I'm going to do it for fun. It's a hobby. I love StarCraft. I love talking about StarCraft. And I'm going to make my friends watch it whether they want to or not.
How did you get over some of the first hurdles that you had with YouTube, and what were they?
I mean, the very first hurdles back then were, number one, when I first started, there was like no such thing as live streaming. There really, that wasn't, I think you could technically live stream, but it was bad, man. It was so bad. Anyone coming into it today definitely missed out on that big shit show. It was horrible. So live streaming wasn't really a thing, and there wasn't very many good record your screen programs. Back then, Fraps was actually the worst thing created by mankind. No computer could actually run Fraps when it first came out. I don't know if they were using it on like the government supercomputers, because I had a beast computer and it did not work with Fraps at all. So it was really hard to find programs to use, which nowadays is super easy. I mean, there's thousands of StarCraft channels now, so the ability to make content is much, much easier. And also, other than the technical aspect, also just learning how to cast. Like, if you watch some of those old videos, I can't even bear myself, because learning how to emphasize while talking and stuff is so huge when it comes to casting. People think that you just sit at a mic and talk about a game and it's great. But you have to be, even the pro players who cast, like, they have to have a little something going on for it to really work out. And trying to figure out exactly how that is, and being able to listen to yourself is like the most excruciatingly painful thing ever. It took me like a year to get over that. So that'd probably be the biggest hurdles.
Do you think any of the problems that you had back then exist today for new content creators on YouTube?
I mean, the main thing is that the programs are readily available now. I would still say the main problem is having the confidence to to just jump in and realize that, I mean, I hate talking about the whole hater thing because you can go to every motivational speech ever about that, but there is going to be haters, and that's a huge aspect of it where you're just like, yeah, I know, there's going to be haters, it's no big deal. And then when everyone's literally like, I'm going to kill you and fucking your whole family because you're so annoying on the internet. Like, I mean, it's kind of hard to get used to. So that definitely is a struggle for anyone. I don't care who you are. Putting up with that for the first year, like, that's going to decide, can you actually make it in this business, or are you not going to be able to? So that's tough. Making a product that people actually want to watch, that's really tough. But the tools are there now. The only thing you have to do is get a good computer, which a lot of kids these days that I know, or at least in talking to other channels that work with a much younger demographic, they say that a lot of kids don't have computers these days. It's more iPads, Xboxes, stuff like that. And if they do have a computer, they're playing Minecraft. So it's definitely, you need a good computer to make the content, and you need the right software, which is so cheap. I mean, XSplit, I forget what it costs, but it is the best investment anyone can make ever if they want to make any sort of video. It's a great starting point. So if you're getting into a hobby, I mean, this hobby might cost you $100 to get started because you need a headset, you need a good computer, which hopefully you already have if you're a total nerd like me. Otherwise, that does cost a lot more. And you also do need XSplit. So it's like $100. Like, just fess up, go buy it, and have some fun, and stay consistent. That's a total pain in the ass.
Consistency is probably the most important one for sure. Do you remember a specific video or moment in time where you realized that, hey, maybe this could be a full-time job, or, sorry, a way to have a salary each year instead of a full-time job? Because you said it basically was with how much time you were spending with it.
So when I first realized that, oh, this is actually a thing, was actually way, way later than it should have been. Because even when StarCraft 2 came out, that's definitely when my channel got the most views by far. Like, I mean, that's not going to be a surprise to anyone because I was covering the newest game that had just come out, and the average life expectancy of a game, it's going to be most popular when it starts and kind of dwindle as time goes on. So some games are different, like League of Legends is currently growing. But either way, when I got my first paycheck is when I was like, oh, I can buy some Taco Bell with this. I'm really excited. And so that's when I first kind of realized that maybe there was something there. I should have actually realized it a lot sooner. It's just I wasn't keeping track of my views at all. I mean, I was getting something like 15 million views a month or something, and I wasn't getting paid for it, and I didn't know that you could get paid for those views. And so I didn't even know I was getting that many views, to be completely honest. I didn't even know how to check. So I should have been watching like a hawk and been like, okay, what videos are people liking? But at the time, I was just blasting stuff out there. And then eventually, when I was able to start the game station and actually start monetizing stuff, that's when I was like, oh, I can also get paid for this. And the cool thing I really liked about it is that I'm not making a product. I'm not forcing people to pay for anything. It's the advertising. That's where almost all my money comes from, is from advertising. And so every time you see an ad on my channel, I mean, yeah, it's like 1/10 of a cent or something. I don't know the exact math on it, but it's really cheap. And so any of the money I make is coming from companies who are also getting something by advertising out of it. So I felt kind of good. I didn't feel like I was swindling anyone. I was just providing free content. I wasn't like, okay, I'm making skateboards. Like, how much should I charge for this? I was just making videos. And eventually when I started making money, it didn't really cost anyone anything. They just have to sit through those ads, and that's it.
You mentioned the game station, which is now probably one of the biggest kind of groups to help out YouTubers, and you guys have so many big YouTubers on the channel. Where did it come from? Where did the idea of that come from?
Okay, I'll try and keep it short, but I get really excited about the game station because it's been kind of my behind the scenes baby, I guess you could say. So basically, to try and condense it down, a couple of years ago, there was no way on YouTube to get a partnership as a gamer. If you had any gaming videos at all, YouTube would not put ads on your videos. They would never talk to you. They would just send you an automated response that says, you make gaming videos, you can keep making them, but you're never going to make money on them. That's their stance, and I think that's still their stance today when it comes to this stuff. But there were, at the time, there was a couple of companies. Machinima is one of them. I know that Curse was trying to get into it. I think IGN's into it now. There's a couple of big companies where YouTube was like, okay, we trust your company enough, we know you're legit enough, that we're going to let you monetize gaming videos, but you have to be careful, because if you get sued, we are booting you out quicker than freaking anything. But of course, any company is going to want money. And this is when it was being acquired by Google and all that. So they're great at advertising. So they trusted these bigger companies. Machinima was, I think, the first, followed up by later the GameStation and IGN and Curse and stuff like that. But so they trust these companies to partner those channels and be able to send ads to the viewers so that they can pay those channels so they have more resources to invest, yada, yada, yada. So way back then, the only company that was sort of doing this was Machinima, but they weren't allowing you to put ads on your own channel. You had to upload your videos to their channel, and then they would sort of pay you based on how many views you got if you reached a certain amount of views. It was a really confusing system, and my main problem with that is I'm putting my heart and soul into videos. I'm not going to give them to someone else's channel. I'm at least going to put them on my own YouTube channel. So they contacted me, and we had some back and forth talks, but I was just thinking, you know what, no. If I'm going to build up my own brand, my own business, my own persona, and really something that I can be proud of, I'm not going to give it to someone else. That's I was very strict on that, very firm, and they refused to partner my channel, so I went on my merry way, and I'm like, okay, yeah, sure, I missed out on money, but whatever, I'm fine. I live with my parents. Who cares? It's going to be whatever. And so that kind of was on the back burner for a couple of months. And then someone came along named David, who I am insanely good friends with now. David is actually kind of the champion of the GameStation, and really, I would say, of gamers on YouTube. I definitely think he's someone who gets no credit for what he was actually able to do. So what David did is, at the time, he was an accountant. And he asked me, hey, do you want me to do your accounting? I said, I don't have any money. There's nothing to account for. And so that was that. And then later he said, hey, I'm meeting with this company who says they can partner your channel. And are you interested in working with me to make that happen? And I was like, all right, prove it. Prove it. Because at this point, it hadn't been done to a single gaming channel. The only channel at that time who had any sort of income from their own personal channel was Red versus Blue. And the way they got away with it is that it wasn't really gameplay footage. It was more like telling stories through Halo. So they were partnered, but no one else with gameplay footage was. And so I was like, all right, if you think I can keep all my content on my channel and all that, then go right ahead, David. Let's see what you got. And he was actually able to get my channel partnered like 24 hours later or something like that. And that's when I finally, after a year and a half, was able to make money on my YouTube channel. I had over 900 videos at the time. No, I think at that point, actually, I had 1,200 because it was during StarCraft 2. And so he was able to do that for me, which was the biggest break I'd ever had in my entire life ever in any way. And so then he was like, well, we partnered your channel. Would you like to start a gaming network where we began partnering other channels? And the idea of that was the coolest idea I'd ever had, because what I had, no one else on YouTube had at that point at all. And this is something that anyone who doesn't make YouTube videos, maybe you don't quite relate to this, and you're just kind of like, what the hell is he talking about? But all the top YouTubers who are doing gaming channels, I mean, it's over a full-time job. You do this every waking hour. You're thinking about it. You're working on it. You're trying to set up meetings. You're trying to do stuff. And at that point, like, the only way to make money was to give your content away. And that doesn't fly with me. I don't care how much money they're giving you. You should own the rights and keep all your own videos and don't give them away. So basically, he presented me with the option of essentially moving to LA, talking to other YouTubers, and seeing if they want to put ads on their channel. And at that time, no one else was doing that. Everyone had told me directly that, number one, we're not going to do it, and number two, they supposedly couldn't do it, which at this point I knew was kind of silly because the company I was working for was going to let me. They're called Maker Studios. And so we launched the GameStation, and we started with something like 20 channels. So it was me, HD was one of them. We got a lot of the StarCraft people right away just because, I mean, those are the people I knew. Like, I knew Day9 and Artosis and like Sci StarCraft and all them. So we were able to get StarCraft relatively easily just because I knew them. And then we launched with some other gaming channels as well. And then all of a sudden, you know, we have a network where there's ads on all the videos. They're able to actually quit their jobs and focus on this full-time, up the quality of it and all that. And that's when just everyone was like, oh, this is actually a good idea. We should either do this ourselves or we should join the GameStation. So that's kind of how, long story short, there's a lot more detail, but so that's a short version, that gamers now can get ads on their YouTube videos. And honestly, David, I mean, I've had him on my live stream. He's the one who mimicked me like crazy. I have the video on my second channel. He's kind of the one who got ads for gamers out there. So if you watch any gaming channel, whether it's Yogscast, whether it's a first-person shooter, whether it's StarCraft, whether it's Day 9, it all kind of started with the GameStation. And the GameStation itself, yes, it is a YouTube channel, but that's only like 0.1% of actually what happens, as it is a big network of like the Yogscast, Total Biscuit, Jesse Cox. All my roommates are part of the GameStation. Again, like Day 9, HD, Total Biscuit, all them. So that's how the GameStation started. That's what I kind of do behind the scenes when I'm not doing YouTube.
Is there a next step for the GameStation, or are you guys just going to kind of keep trucking along with what you're doing right now?
I mean, obviously, it'll be trucking along, but there definitely is next steps. One of the things behind the scenes is something called a CPM, which I know Total Biscuit went into great detail about this, so I won't go too crazy with it. But CPMs are basically how much you make per 1,000 views. So if you have a $1 CPM, every 1,000 views, you're making about $1. It's not an exact formula, and it fluctuates daily. But one of the goals of the GameStation is to raise that CPM as high as it can go. So say you watch Hulu, for example. When you're watching those ads are at an extremely high CPM because they're ads that are played before like mainstream television shows. And so they're making extremely high CPMs. So part of the GameStation behind the scenes is getting that CPM high so people like Total Biscuit can invest in new computers, they can invest in traveling, they can afford to go to these major events and all that. So raising that CPM has been a main focus, but really, the GameStation is part of a company called Maker Studios, and Maker Studios recently, I mean, they just signed like Snoop Dogg, Terry Crews, he's in the Expendables movie that just came out a couple of days ago. So they're starting to sign really, really big actors out there, and this is something that I don't know if people realize. The GameStation is attached to Maker Studios. They have the same office, it's the same CEO at the very, very top. So they have access to all those resources. So you're going to actually start seeing like Snoop Dogg in a lot more YouTube videos. You're going to see Terry Crews in a lot more YouTube videos. And really trying to bring gaming to what I think it should be as popular as it can be. So basically just getting big name talent is going to be another thing. Also things like producing bigger music videos like Nerd Alert, for example. We have another one coming out. And just always trying to raise the bar instead of just like, okay, here's someone playing Happy Wheels. Also, that's great, but also how can you have other really cool content? And that's kind of what Maker Studios helps facilitate, other than actually partnering your channel, which no one else did before Maker and TGS.
Now, I want to talk a little bit about your channel specifically. Compared to when you were saying you were getting about 15 million views a month, comparing that to now, it's definitely started to decline in some fashion. What do you think is the cause of that, the decline in views for your channel?
Yeah, absolutely. It's something that I keep a very close eye on. And I mean, to be quite honest, I mean, these stats are basically publicly available if you know where to look. At the peak of StarCraft, I was getting probably about 16, 18 million views a month. And now I'm down to about around 6 million. So I mean, it's definitely, I mean, that's a huge hit. No one's going to argue that. And so I think that there is countless things going on here. Number one, am I being consistent enough with my good content, like Nerd Alert, for example? Am I being as good as I should be about releasing Nerd Alert's animated series? Again, the scheduling thing is going to be a big issue. At the same time, though, I don't think it's 100% that. I don't think it's all of a sudden people hate me. I don't think that they watch me for 2 years and they're just like, I can't stand this guy anymore. I'm breaking up with him. I mean, there is some of that. You will see a lot of people say, well, I watched Husky and then I started watching Day 9, and then that's when I found Team Liquid. Like that, I've seen that post probably 10,000 times. So is it that, or is it that StarCraft is on the decline itself? I think it's kind of a mix of so many things. Like if you keep track of the stats on any StarCraft related site, any live stream, so whether you're watching TLO, Day 9, any live stream tournament that just basically focuses on live streaming through Twitch, I mean, it's kind of obvious, everyone's down in views. You can watch IEM, for example, and their views aren't as good. You can watch TSL4. Any tournament, it's no surprise, or it should be no surprise, that the views are definitely down. The reason I say that it shouldn't be a surprise is because, I mean, you get the excitement of a decade of hype right when the game comes out. So the first couple of months, even the first year, is, of course, it's going to be blown out of the water. But if you look at any stats for any game that's been out that long, it definitely starts to dwindle. So what is the root cause? I mean, there's a lot of stuff. My demographic is 25 to 32-year-old males. That's my biggest demographic. Of course, I have everything else sprinkled throughout. But all my friends are 25 to 32-year-old males, and everyone I've met that is about 25 to 32, I feel like that's kind of when you start getting away from watching videos online, and you get more towards having a full-time job. You get more towards having a career, maybe even a family. And so really everyone I know in that age group, right now, they don't sit and watch YouTube videos all the time. They have something else going on. So I think people are starting to get a little bit older. They're starting to go for more jobs. And also, I mean, people are kind of waiting for Heart of the Swarm. They're wanting to see, you know, what are the new units? How is it going to interact with the metagame and all that? So there's definitely a lot of stuff going on. But StarCraft II is still way ahead, at least outside of Korea. I don't know too much about inside Korea at all. But outside Korea, StarCraft II is still much bigger than it was during the Brood War years. So I think the longevity of StarCraft is very apparent. With some of the upcoming changes that Blizzard has already announced, I think it's going to be helping out a lot. But, I mean, yeah, views are definitely down, but it really shouldn't be too much a surprise to anyone who followed StarCraft Brood War. Because, I mean, it's going to happen. It's just going to happen. That's how it is.
Is there anything you're doing in specifically to kind of differentiate yourself in your channel, or are you just going to stick to what you've been doing for quite a long time now?
I'm definitely never going to quit StarCraft. When I'm 50, if you meet me on the street, you can hold it to me and be like, "I remember when you said." But I'm definitely never going to stop doing StarCraft. Even if everything on TV, every YouTube video, every person in the world is making StarCraft content, I just love watching the StarCraft content. And at this point, I have it down to a science where, you know, it's not much more work to actually just make a video if I'm going to be watching the whole replay anyway. So I'm always going to be doing that. But at the same time, I mean, I really do like making things like the Nerd Alert music videos, because I think doing stuff like that, it helps StarCraft a lot more than just making StarCraft videos. I think it's good to raise the bar to try and make stuff that people are going to enjoy, whether or not they actually watch StarCraft. They can find this music video, be like, haha, I know what Banelings are. It's kind of funny. and so I definitely want to keep making, Nerd Alert especially, I want to do more animated stuff because I think it's really important to raise the bar. I don't think we should kind of stagnate and stop at just, okay, well, here's a StarCraft tournament over and over and over, the same format every time. I definitely think there's ways, even now, to bring in new viewers, to bring in people who haven't seen it before, and trying to figure out how to get people excited about the game again. And some of the stuff I've seen for Heart of the Swarm, I think is actually going to really do that, because I think part of the problem with StarCraft right now is that the social aspect was completely non-existent for 2 full years. So everyone I know who still plays WoW, they love the social aspect of that. That's why that game, I mean, they still have millions of subscribers. They're still making bank on that game, and it's really, really old. So I feel like the social aspect of StarCraft has been completely absent from the game. I feel like that's why a lot of people have kind of dropped off from the game, because, you know, they played maybe ladder for a year, and then they just don't want to do that anymore. They just want to play more casual stuff. But how do you interact with people who want to do that? And so I think right now the social aspect has gotten better. They did add a button that'll throw you into a general chat, but I think with Heart of the Swarm, the players that come back for that game are going to stick a lot better, because there's going to be more social aspects involved with Heart of the Swarm, and I feel like that's a major part of it. I think that Blizzard may have underestimated the importance of social networking, social tools, and all that. Putting a Facebook link is not what you want in StarCraft. What you want is a way to interact with people, to be able to chat with them, also to even have a way of seeing people in chat and being like, okay, this guy's bronze, maybe I'll message him and play some games and we can become practice buddies. So I think that's going to be fixed in Heart of the Swarm. I really hope so. And if it does, I think you'll see StarCraft stick a lot better. But, I mean, even 2 years in, I mean, StarCraft's doing great. But, yeah, I would definitely agree that overall views are down.
I want to go back to doing content kind of outside of esports. You've caught a lot of flack recently for doing some live streams, helping out Rosanna Pansino. I apologize if I said the name.
No, you nailed it, man.
Okay, good, good. And her her Nerdy Nummies, I think, is one of her biggest video hits on her YouTube. But you've been catching a lot of shit, basically, for doing a lot of this. And people are saying that your commitment to esports is starting to kind of dwindle, and you're starting to do things outside of that. What do you have to say to those people?
I don't say anything to those people, to be completely honest. Anyone who looks at my YouTube channel, yeah, there might be a week where I only upload 6 videos, but I still try and hit 2 to 3 videos a day. I don't know how many videos I have right now. It's almost 1,900, I think. Plus, I deleted 800 to 900 videos before StarCraft II came out. So, I mean, I've made like 2,700 StarCraft videos. So anyone who would actually sit back and be like, all right, well, his commitment to the esports scene is severely lacking, I'm like, whatever, man. You know what? There are things that I like. Believe it or not, there's things outside of StarCraft that I actually enjoy doing. I know it's weird. It's a crazy, crazy thought. But I really, really do enjoy new media. I feel like new media is the future of, I wouldn't say entertainment, but it's definitely the future for our generation as far as how they consume content. We're talking about Netflix, Hulu, things like that, and YouTube especially. I really enjoy doing stuff like that. I like being able to make a music video without having to, you know someone in Hollywood who knows a director, who knows a camera crew. I like being able to do that kind of stuff. So anyone who says, like, oh, he doesn't commit to esports and all that, I mean, it's just kind of silly. Honestly, if I upload 8 videos a day like I used to, I mean, it burns people out. There's so much StarCraft content out there that I think it would just be absolutely silly for me to make 10 videos a day and not try and focus on what kind of stuff are people going to want to watch coming up. Are they just going to want to watch more StarCraft? Because if they do, I have a lot of that. If they're going to want to watch something else, like a music video, an animated series, a web series or something like that, then I should definitely make that kind of content too. So I'm a gamer at heart. I'm a huge Blizzard fanboy, but I mean, I played WoW for 4 years. I love other games just than StarCraft. So there will always be a StarCraft presence. I'm always going to do tournaments here and there. I'm always going to be making lots of StarCraft content. It's always my number one focus. But at the same time, I mean, it's just silly. It is actually silly if you step back and take a look at it to complain that I'm not making 10 StarCraft videos a day. So I don't say anything to those people other than just, I'm glad you like StarCraft as much as I do, and I'm glad you're enthusiastic, but there's a tournament every weekend, so you're going to survive, and it's going to be okay, and I'm just going to do what I love for a living. I think that, I don't know, it's kind of interesting, because when I watch someone doing something they love for a living, that's what I'm entertained by, as opposed to, okay, now to day 9, is he going to be talking about this hardcore strategy that's popping up on the Korean ladder? Because if not, I'm not going to watch him. What I'm personally attracted to is people doing what they love for a living, whether it's what I first found them doing or whether it's something that they're really excited about and they want to share with the world. So they all just need to keep posting, because I love those posts. They're probably my favorite posts that I can read right now.
Your Nerd Alert series is probably one of your most popular, if not the most popular series with such hits, I can't believe I'm about to say this, as Banelings and Nerdy and I Know It. Which one is your favorite that's out there already that you've worked on and why?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know, because right now there's only 4 public songs. We're currently editing a 5th right now, and I know this is going to upset a lot of people, but our 5th song is not StarCraft related. It is still, of course, Nerdy related. And
you son of a bitch.
I know. Everyone posts about it. He's losing his passion. He's no longer making StarCraft related pop songs. So I definitely like Banelings. I mean, obviously it has the most views, but it always gets more traffic when we release another video. But I definitely like Banelings, because that's when I first realized, like, there's stuff other that you can do other than just yelling about a video game, which I'm going to be doing a lot. You can ask my neighbors, man. That's all I do all day. But there's also other stuff that people really enjoy watching, like Banelings. So I would say Banelings is one of my favorite ones, but every song has something special in my heart. Banelings, number one, I think the special thing was it was my first high-produced video, high-quality, I guess you could call it, compared to what I've done in the past. And also, that's when Twitch TV... they didn't exist back then. Back then, they were just Justin TV. But that's when Justin TV also started to really get their act together. And they were also the ones who let me borrow the Lamborghini. So I always had that, like, to me,
really?
That was kind of the start of, so they were the ones who let me loan that. And all I had to do was give them feedback on their website. And I made them this is kind of off topic, but I made a bulleted list of 10 things right before the music video came out that I think they should improve on. And they actually implemented every single bullet point.
And you got a Lamborghini for that.
Yeah,
for
and I
your
gotta
video.
Borrow one. I wish it was my Lamborghini.
What the
like
Twitch,
like,
I'll
oh
give you
my
10.
God, he's making so much money, he could just drive a Lamborghini in a video. And I'm like, guys, I borrowed it they let me sit in it for like 2 minutes, and then they like washed it because I was so dirty. But I'm gonna be honest. If I ever get a Lamborghini, I'm gonna flaunt that damn car so much that I don't even care what anyone says because I'm in a Lamborghini. Anyway, so that was from Twitch TV. So I always have that good memory. And also, that's when I think they started getting their act together and they really started being a powerhouse in not only StarCraft but in gaming in general. So I had that good memory. SCB Love Song, I love it because we were parodying boy bands from when we were growing up in like the early 90s. And I felt like most people didn't quite get that joke. They're just like, oh, you guys look so homosexual. And we're like, that's the whole point of the video. So I like that one because we filmed it on a beach. And it's like a super love song, basically. So I like that. I love Void Rays because it's parodying the most annoying song to ever grace YouTube. And we pulled it off, I think. So anyway, so I like that. Nerdy, I know it. Probably my least favorite, but people tell me that they like it. I find my voice to be just so painfully annoying in that song. But the next song that's coming out, even though it's not StarCraft related, so I'm giving you guys advance warning, it's actually my favorite song. So
it can you give us a name or anything, any details about it?
It's gonna be out like in. It's supposed to be done tomorrow, so we'll see if it comes out tomorrow or not. But it's not StarCraft related. It's a game that every single person knows. It is another love song, which Kurt has like a thing for love songs, man. So I don't know if my demographic's gonna like it. I hope so, because we had a ton of fun on this video and also making the song. But it's gonna be another love song. It's gonna be a love triangle that people have always said exists in gaming, and we'll see. We'll see if people like it.
Okay, all right. I know where you're going with this now. I don't want to spoil it for anyone else, but makes sense. We'll talk about it after the.
Oh yeah, no, I can't wait. I don't want to spoil it just because Kurt put his heart and soul into it, and I don't know if he'd be mad at me. But when it comes out, please support it just to help out Kurt because Okay, so Kurt, for those of you who don't know, he works with people like on Nickelodeon shows, and he's signed as a professional songwriter to like write for Justin Bieber. Like he's got it going on. And so every time I come up to him, I'm like, "Hey, Kurt, let's write another love song about video game characters." I always feel bad if like the video just is gonna bomb because he definitely goes way out of his way to help little nerdy me make some music videos. So go support Kurt. He's awesome. He deserves it.
Awesome. Well, I know a lot of people are looking forward to that. Let's switch gears and talk about your casting. What would you say is your greatest strength in broadcasting and also your weakest?
Oh, God, it's like a job interview, JP. Yeah. I get really excited, and I guess you could say that's my strength. Is it weird for me to say that? I don't know. But the style I've always done since the beginning is what I genuinely feel on the inside when I see some crazy micro from Tasia or I see crazy baneling landmines and stuff like that. Like, I actually legitimately am flipping my shit. And so a lot of people are like, oh, he's fake. He's not really excited. He's just doing it for attention. No, I'm not. Like, I don't know how else to convince people. So at least, if nothing else, I am completely genuine when it comes to being excited, loving casting tournaments and things like that. My weakness, I mean, I guess you could ask the people who watch me. Really the only people who say my weakness is my analytical style, I only really get that on Reddit and Team Liquid. Everywhere else, like on YouTube or at live events and stuff like that, the support seems to be, this guy's super excitable. He's not too annoying. Like, I can kind of tolerate him. But it's mostly Team Liquid and Reddit. But, I mean, those are the places you're going to go anyways and expect that kind of feedback. Because they're the ones watching the tournaments as they're happening the moment. They're going to be leaving their feedback. They're very vocal. So I guess if you ask Team Liquid, they would say my analytical style. But honestly, like, I just get excited about the game. And I don't want to do a casting style that I don't think is true to myself. Because I feel like that would just be silly. So when I first started, for the first 2 years, I took tons of feedback. I still take feedback to this day. After most events, I'll ask people for their feedback. But at the same time, I mean, I'm always going to be that guy who freaks out. So if you're expecting that to change, yeah, you've been waiting for the wrong person. So definitely go watch Artosis, Apollo, or Day 9, because they know way more than I'll ever know about the game. But I just love the game. I think it's an infectious game, and I try and hype people up that way. So I don't know, but hopefully I get the job, JP, for this interview.
You've had some negative words thrown at you from a lot of professional players, especially at the beginning of your casting career. I believe Idra was definitely one of them, that where you guys shared some words on a forum or somewhere. But has this changed? Do you still get a lot of shit from pro players? Or is there any reason on from your side of things why you think you do?
I'm trying to think. I mean, I pay so little attention to that stuff that I can't even remember what the Idra thing was. I think Noni one time said that I'm too popular and the player should be more popular. I'm trying to remember what. Do you remember what it was? Like, I don't remember. Was it that I only pick games where he loses? Is that the one?
I think it was you only pick games that he loses. Yeah, I think that was one of the complaints that Idra had.
Okay, well, if you could just send me replay packs of him winning 20 games, then I would cast all of them. So any time that there's a complaint from a pro player, I think, number one, it's a player who hasn't met me in person. And also, number two, is a player who, for whatever reason, doesn't want free publicity. So I don't really know what the deal is there. I'm trying to remember who threw words at me, because I honestly, I don't care, because I'm having so much fun doing what I want. But, I mean, TLO, White Raw, are great examples where they're some of the most popular players out there, but they don't have huge tournament results to back it up. I mean, they are making $300,000 in tournament winnings, like MC, for example. And, you know, why are they popular? It's because they interact with the personalities. They have great personalities. They're very open to, okay, maybe he cast a game where he shit-talked me and said my play was terrible, but it was seen by 300,000 people. So now all those people know me and are aware of my name. So, I mean, if the pro players want to smack talk me, I mean, go right ahead. That's whatever. I don't care. So I don't even know, JP. They're going to say, it kind of reminds me of the whole, well, he doesn't focus on esports anymore. When it's for 2 years, it was this guy's casting is terrible. And then I take the feedback and I get to where it's not terrible. And right. Then those same exact people, if you check their posting history, I'm more than willing to bet they're the people who are okay, well, now all y'all like him. But, here's this thing that you shouldn't like about it. It's not ever going to change. But the way I look at it is I could give 100 people, I'll just say on Team Liquid, just as an example, but 100 people, I could give them $100. So I'm giving away a lot of money. So 100 people get $100. There's going to be that one guy who's you're rich on YouTube. Why don't you give me $200? And it's just shut up. I give up. I'm done. I'm just going to keep doing my thing. And there's always going to be that 10% who they're... Whatever. They're fun. I love them.
I want to touch on that a little bit more. Does that really, at the end of the day, does it affect you that much? Or are you just the type of person where you can put it aside and just move on with your life?
Yeah, you know, I've always, we were talking about high school a little bit. I've always been able to deal with harsh words, being bullied, being bad things said about me, personal messages that are I'm going to rape you. And I'm okay. And I would consider myself to have really thick skin when it comes to that stuff. And I would say for the first year, it was definitely really hard. I'm not going to lie. It was very tough to be basically bearing your soul out there. And especially when it's your voice, that's such a sensitive thing with people. Anytime you watch a video of yourself, most people are oh God, I actually sound like that. That's kind of stupid. So to have people shit all over that, yeah, sure. It hurts. But eventually I realized does that person enjoy their life more than I'm enjoying my life? And again, not talking about haters too much, but I realize most of them probably actually don't. If you think about it, they probably aren't having as much fun as I'm having. So if they're posting a hateful comment, the really important thing is to realize where are they coming from? What state is their life in right now? Are they actually trying to give good feedback? Are they a fan who's Husky, you're doing this, but it's really annoying. You got to stop. Is it that, or is it just more the guy had a bad day at work and he comes home and he's I'm going to try and make people on the internet feel bad. I don't know. So nowadays it doesn't get me unless it's someone who I know is a fan or they make a really well thought out post. And even then it's not so much that it hurts me. It's that I feel kind of bad for giving a performance that people didn't like. So the way to get to at least me, which is different with Total Biscuit, because you can post Total Biscuit, your nose is big, and he'll make a Reddit post about it and never shut up about it. So to get to me, you can't do that. What you have to do is really think about what you're saying, use periods and capital letters, and make a valid argument for why what I'm doing is either incorrect or it bugs you. Those are the ones I listen to, and the people I really listen to are the ones at events who actually have the balls to come up and say, Husky, I know you're doing great things, but these are the things I don't like about you, let me tell you. Because those are the people who are actually legit. the people who post online on forums, like, if they're shit-talking, unless they got the balls to say it in person, then I don't really care. So, long story short, it doesn't really affect me anymore, but it used to.
It used to.
Yeah, for sure.
I want to talk about some of these big events. You know, you started off, I think, at the first MLG ever. It was you and HD, myself and Day 9 there, and you did a lot of big events for quite some time. Most recently, you started to really pull out of some of these big events from the caster lineup. Is there a reason to this? Do you plan on doing more events later? Are you just taking a break? What's going on?
So I definitely plan to do more events, especially anything on the West Coast. Like, I'm going to be up at PAX doing some cool stuff with Day 9 there and stuff like that. So also the MLG, anytime they're in Anaheim, you'll notice I'm there. It's not that MLG is like, well, Husky sucks. We don't want him at any of our events. And it's not like all the events are just like, this guy's terrible. He's falling apart. His YouTube views are down. We saw a horrible post about him on Reddit. Like, they're not doing that. A lot of the people who run these tournaments are great, great guys, and ladies as well. There's a lot of people in esports. But really, last year, 2011 for me, my badges are almost within reach. They're in that drawer over there. I can't show them on camera because they're just a little bit out of reach. But I flew on a plane more than 30 times last year, and it got to the point where I was flying so much that I was flying a couple of times a month, and each time you do an event, it takes about a week out of you because you have to get there a day early, you have to leave a day after. At least that's how I do it, so I can be at the top of my game. Plus, the events tend to be between 2 and 3 days, so you know it's about 5 or 6 days for each event. So when you're flying twice a month, that's basically half your time gone from each month doing events. And now there's so many more events that if I just did events, I would never actually be home. I would be always traveling. Day 9, he had to take a month-long vacation just because he was traveling so, so much. And so last year, I just went all in. I did every event that I could within the United States, and I just did as much as I could. And then 2012 came around, and I started realizing, like, I'm traveling so much that I'm hating the idea of taking a vacation somewhere. And so that's when I got to the point of I'm flying too much. I need to slow down. I'm wearing myself out and just do the events that I think are – that they fit into my schedule, because again, I have like the game station, my YouTube channel, my second YouTube channel, plus making music videos. There's a lot going on there. So when I do an event, I really want it to be something that fits into my schedule, is something that is not going to exhaust me, because that's gonna ruin my whole casting style. Because if I don't have like 10 hours of sleep before an event, like my casting style, I feel like suffers. And so it's getting to the point where I love doing events. But I feel like, number one, I can help esports from the comfort of LA. And also, I mean, I was straight up exhausted. I mean, there's no other way to put it. And any personality who travels a lot, they will tell you, traveling, and players especially, they get it way worse than I ever could. When you travel too much, it will get to you. It'll make you suffer, whether you're a player or whether you're a caster. And some of the casters, like, this is their primary thing that they have going on. So like Tasis and Artosis, for example, they spend a lot of time traveling because that is 100% their main focus. They're going to be live event casters for God knows how long. I hope forever, because I love the guys. So that's why they're able to fly like 1 week in Germany, then they're back in Korea, and then the next week they're somewhere in like the United States. That's why they're able to do it. So it was just getting to be a little bit too much, and I didn't want to wear myself out. I didn't want to hate traveling. And so I definitely plan to do events that are close, and doing special events, like especially if it's with Day 9, for example. I love working with him. So there are certain events that I do. No, I haven't been banned or stopped getting invites. I know I see those posts where it's like, well, Husky wasn't in Sweden this weekend, so they don't like him. No, I've been invited to a lot of those events. It's just traveling's brutal, man. I feel like anyone who travels for a living can kind of agree.
Now, I know you got a lot of European fans, and you mentioned that you only do events within the U.S. Do you have any plans of going outside of the U.S. to DreamHack or to an IEM or anything like that in the future?
You know, I've talked to basically every caster who's done those events, and they're crazy well-produced events, but the casting lineup, I mean, they're getting better now. They're starting to hire more and more casters, but it definitely is exhausting for them. I think if I am going to be doing a tournament in Europe, I would want the lineup, number one, to be awesome. I'd want, like, Day 9, Apollo, like, Artosis. I'd want it to be, like, an MLG-style event where everyone is there, just because I feel like that's really how you're going to knock a tournament out of the water and really try and get more views. Is by having that. So if I were to do one, I would want to know way in advance, just because again, the traveling. Like, I'm going to be driving up to Seattle from L.A. For PAX, which is like the 31st or something like that. So, I mean, I'm still doing a lot of traveling and stuff like that. So I do want to get to Europe, though, and I do want to go to South Korea at least once to kind of – just to kind of experience all that. So at some point, I definitely want to. I don't know. I don't think I have anything on my calendar right now, though.
I also want to talk about, you mentioned having a lot of casters at the events, and that's one of the best ways to knock it out of the park. What do you think about the amount of work involved at something like an MLG or some of these other events that you've casted at? Is it too much for casters sometimes?
I mean, it's really on a event-by-event basis, and it's one of those easy things to be kind of in the – be a fan, for example, a spectator, and just be like, oh, well, Day Niner Husky, all they're doing is yelling about a game for a couple hours. What's the big deal? But it really – you have to experience it firsthand. Number one, all the traveling. Number two, you have got to be in mental tip-top shape. And the when it becomes a problem is if you're casting for like 12 hours a day. Number one, I think it's really bad for the sport to have content out there where the casters are not like – way into it. Imagine if football, for example, where you tune into football and the casters are just like, oh my god, he got the ball. Like, that is not good for any sport. And so anytime I see a caster where they've been casting for 12 hours a day, I mean, yes, it's going to get the tournament more views, but, you know, it's just too much. They're going to lose their edge. And yes, they may not be physically exhausted from lifting heavy bricks all day, but it definitely wears on you. Your voice starts to go out. Mentally, you don't even, like, you'll be looking at the screen and just, you don't even know what you're looking at anymore because you've been watching and casting for 12 hours. So I would say it's on an event-by-event basis. I wouldn't call out any, like, specific companies. It's just that if you're going to have an event that goes for 12 hours a day for 3 days, you have to have people switching in and out constantly. Because mentally, it is very, very exhausting. Just like playing. I mean, go play ladder for an hour. If you aren't mentally exhausted, then you're probably like Dong Rei Gu and you play for a living. Because playing StarCraft is mentally exhausting, and casting is very exhausting as well. And I guess really the only way to prove it is to have someone cast a major tournament. But sure. Just know it is exhausting, and the casters definitely need breaks. And definitely, that's why I think having lots of casters is definitely the way to go. Because it just makes your event better, and it makes StarCraft look better, and it makes it look a lot less unprofessional. Because, again, you're not having casters who just are hating their lives at any given time.
Last question I have on the topic of casting. You do a ton of solo casting on your channel. Is there a player or a team that you get sent a replay or a replay plaque, and it really, really gets you excited?
I mean, Team Liquid's great. They by far release the most replay packs out of any team that I've seen. I mean, I always love casting White Rod just because White Rod, I mean, he's like the oldest guy in esports. He has a wife. He has a house over there in Ukraine. I always like helping him out however I can because he, I mean, there's few people who are as dedicated to StarCraft as he's been. He's been playing it since it came out professionally and has been playing it ever since. Never, I don't even think, even thinking of retiring because he always gets sponsorships. So I love White Raw. Of course, I love TLO. TLO really gets the importance of being a good personality, getting your face out there and all that. But really, I mean, the only thing that I wish I could get more of is the Kespa players because those are the players that I cast when I first started out. I mean, we're talking about Jadonk, Flash, Bisou, Stork, so many more. I mean, I don't even have to list all of them. So in the future, if I do have those replays come my way, that I'm going to be so fanboy biased during those casts that I'm just going to warn everyone ahead of time. So those I would be really excited about too. But really, any player who directly contacts me and is like, Husky, can you please just cast some of my games? Those are the players I really like. Because those are the ones who realize how important it is to be a personality, not just a name when it comes to the game. Because I mean, imagine the UFC if the players had no personality and they just punched each other in the face and you couldn't even see their face. Like, I think getting the personalities out there, not only casters, but especially players, I think is important. So any player who wants to build that persona, wants to build that image, and wants to build that fan base, those are the players that I get really excited about. Because I feel like they kind of get it. It's not just a game. It's also, like, if you want the game to be more successful, you have to have interesting people. If it was just the game with no casters, no personality, no one would watch it. It's called a replay. They get downloaded, like, 50 times. It's not going to be watched a lot. So personalities are huge in both the caster and the player. So any player who has a good personality, I'm all for.
Now, I want to talk about just esports in general and some of these other titles within esports. You've stayed, obviously, strictly within the realm of StarCraft II. What are your thoughts on the world of MOBA, of the MOBA genre? Well, yeah, I can't say the word. Whatever.
Whatever, man. League of Legends, all that good
there
stuff.
You go. There you go.
So I have always loved the idea of competitive games. I remember when I was much younger, just watching competitive Counter-Strike, for example, on Half-Life TV. I mean, that's some old school stuff. Had to go way out of your way to actually be able to watch that. And I've always loved the idea of competitive sports. Now, of competitive games, excuse me. And so obviously StarCraft is my favorite game. I mean, that's no surprise at all. I think it's the best game ever made. I love it. I love Blizzard. I can't help it. But when it comes to other games, like, everyone should be supportive of every other professional game out there. Whether it doesn't matter if you're, like, watching the event and being like, yeah, go League teams. It's just more like the idea of any esport. Like, you should definitely support it. Even if you think that, you know, it shouldn't be an esport, I think the idea of competitive gaming as a whole, like, the more people who are watching League of Legends, that's more people who very well may get into StarCraft. So maybe they're playing League and they're like, I don't really like this. What else is there? Then there's a good chance they're going to find StarCraft. I feel like all the games kind of support each other. To smack talk any esport, I feel like is so stupid. Like, just focus on the esport you like. And I personally, I don't play League of Legends. I don't play Dota and stuff like that. Uh-huh. That's just because I just don't like those kind of games. I mean, it has nothing to do with how the games are made. It has nothing to do with the company. I just prefer the hecticness and the chaoticness of StarCraft and trying to not make any mistakes the whole game. One mistake can end up costing you. I like that aspect of StarCraft. I think that's what's great about it. But every time I see the stream numbers for League or for any FPS, or even if it's just a new game that's going to have its little 5 minutes of fame, I always get excited. I mostly just watch StarCraft, though. So go esports. You guys are great.
Riot Games announced, I think it was last week, maybe the week before, some huge plans for their third season, the League of Legends tournament. I think it's called the Championship Series for Season 3. Buzzwords like millions in terms of prize money and salaries for all the players and teams have been brought up. Do you have any intentions of covering League of Legends in any capacity?
So anytime I cover a game, especially if it's going to be for an event, I want it to be a game that, number one, I'm confident in knowing what the hell's going on. It's not necessarily knowing the meta game to a T because I've watched every day 9 daily. It's more understanding the idea of the game and what's going on, and also having experience playing that game. And right now, I just don't have that for League of Legends. So for me, like, I would have to play it a lot. I would have to know what is actually worth getting excited about, what's not worth getting excited about, what players are cool, what players are not that great, and just trying to get a good feel for the game. And right now, I mean, honestly, I don't have that for League of Legends. I've watched some League of Legends casts. I think that there are casters there who fill basically what I would explain as my exact role. So I think it'd be kind of silly for me to get into that, but if there was ever a game, like if there's some obscure fighting game that I liked as a kid and they released that as an esport randomly, I don't know what the hell happened. That's something I would feel comfortable casting because I have history with that game. I'm not being someone I'm not really true to. Like, so if I start casting League of Legends, I don't think it would be me unless I had played it for a long time. So me personally, I would only cover games that I'm really excited about. And that's why I'm covering, like, Pokemon Blue, for example. I played that as a kid. I loved
Sick.
It. Yeah, and it's a badass game, so that's why I can play that game, and I can just have fun with it on my second channel. And whether people like it or not, I don't think that actually matters. So I don't know. I would only cover a game if I really, really liked it.
And drawing comparisons to kind of Riot Games compared to Blizzard, do you think Blizzard's doing a poor job in comparison in terms of supporting esports?
I don't think it's so much esports. Again, I think a lot of it has to do with the social aspects of Brood War compared to StarCraft, too. I think that the social aspect needs to be a lot better. I think Blizzard is doing a lot of things now as far as doing live events, like sending a representative there, and you see the CEO for example, at the events. I think doing that stuff is wildly important. Did Blizzard jump on the new media bandwagon a little bit late? I think that they did, but I also think that they are being very smart about it moving forward. The way I say it like that is, think about Valve, for example. Valve has such goodwill in the community. Right now, they can do no wrong. There's Gaben that everyone loves. And I think that with those big companies, MLG is a good example, I think, as well, is that the new way of doing business, I feel like, in this industry, is to have someone who is a personality at that company that people can relate to. So a lot of people, they love Sundance because he's straight shooting. He gets it. Blah, blah, blah. There's stuff that you can point to that's like, okay, this is a good image of Blizzard. I don't follow Riot too much. I imagine that they have done stuff like that because I know they personally go to tournaments a lot. So I think it would do Blizzard a lot of good to be more public, which in the past, I mean, Blizzard has been very private when it comes to their CEO and when it comes to stuff like some of the developers. I've met the developers of StarCraft 2, and they are amazing guys. Like, they're in a freaking band. They do so much cool stuff. And that kind of stuff, I think, is as equally as important as making a Rockstar-level game. Like, not the company. I do love Rockstar. But, like, basically making a game that everyone's going to love, you have to do that as well as also have a good face. So Gaben, I think, is a perfect example. So Blizzard does that more as well as add the social aspect. I feel like the tournaments will get the viewership that they need to help building that up, because I do know, for example, for sure that Blizzard has begun working directly with tournaments now in a lot of ways that they haven't in the past, is trying to figure out, hey, what tools can we give you to make this a better experience for everyone? I think you'll see that kind of stuff play out. I mean, Blizzard's still trying to feel it out, because before, when you did business, you didn't really have the employees be the superstars. It was always like mascots and silly stuff like that. So I feel like if Blizzard evolves a little bit, they start understanding new media, they understand why it's important to have a public figure representing their company, why it's important to interact with the fans a lot more. I think if they do that, then everything else is going to kind of fill out. And also listening to the feedback of the community is huge. And I know for a fact that they're working on that stuff as well for Heart of the Swarm. So I don't know too much about Riot, so I can't say who's doing better at what. I don't think that just throwing millions of dollars into prize pools is the best way to do it. I mean, it doesn't hurt. Like, I would love for the pro gamers now to be making millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars even. But there's a lot more to it than just flaunting around money saying, hey, we make a successful game, we're going to pay players this amount of money. There's a lot more to it than that. So I think Blizzard can tap into those kind of things other than just throwing money around.
You pretty much answered every single one of my follow-ups for that, so we'll just move on straight to the next question. Do you have any other esports which you follow outside of StarCraft 2?
I mean, I've always loved Counter-Strike. I wouldn't say that I follow it, but anytime I see it, I just love watching it. I kind of really want to get into, I mean, it's not really an esport. I kind of want to get into Magic, but the casters I've seen, I've only watched like two events, so I don't know who else is out there, but I feel like the casters for Magic the Gathering, I kind of want to cast a Magic the Gathering tournament just to see if losing my shit when someone like doesn't draw a land when he really needs it, like if people would watch that or not. I don't know if that would be stupid. But
you should definitely try it. Just go to a Magic tournament with Sean, and just
oh my god, that would be amazing.
Cast. It would be hilarious.
And have Sean like learn the game really well, and he does. He actually plays a ton of Magic online. I don't know if this is like public knowledge.
I don't.
But he plays a shit ton. Oh my god, he plays so much. So he could be doing like the analytical casting. I could be like, Sean, he just played a Plague Rats. I don't know. It might be fun. So I would like to follow that more. But honestly, when it comes to gaming, I would say I follow a lot more casual stuff, and then I follow hardcore StarCraft. And the other esports, like, I don't know. I'm not really that much of an FPS guy outside of Counter-Strike. So I guess the answer is no, JP. No, I do not.
All right. Well, I am almost done. I got four more questions. So subscribers, if you guys have a chat, or if you have a question for Husky, go ahead and get them ready, and then we'll do those at the very end of the show. So it's ridiculous that you're one of the hardest working people and passionate people in the scene that I know, a quality that a lot of people really don't see, because you just produce content. You don't do that much live streams. I know you started to do some more vlogs, and it's kind of showing that. But what drives this passion for you? What, at the end of the day, makes you get up the next morning and do it all over again?
I mean, I feel like I've been blessed with a great opportunity here. I mean, number one, casting live StarCraft tournaments alone, I mean, that's more than I could ever ask for ever in my entire life. And so even if I was just doing that, I would be more than happy just making StarCraft videos and doing tournaments. You can't ask for a better job than that. And then also, like, A lot of people, I mean, they really don't know a whole lot about Maker Studios. That's a name that maybe people even haven't heard. But the people that work at Maker Studios are far and away probably the best people, I mean, I've ever worked with. They are the coolest people. They moved from around the world to basically pursue the exact thing that they want to do for a living. They aren't working at a job that they hate. They aren't doing it just to get by because they have to. They are dedicated to doing what they love for a living. And I feel like that is something that's so admirable that it's just so cool to work around that kind of energy. So Kurt, for example, like I was saying, he writes songs for – he's submitted songs like Justin Bieber and stuff. Like, who do you know that gets to do that? It's so awesome. Like Kasim G is one of the big talents there. He gets to basically be a dick on videos to everyone he ever meets, and he gets paid for it, and he absolutely loves it. So, like, being able to see people do what they love for a living, whether it's trolling people, playing video games, doing whatever, it always reminds me that I'm very fortunate to be able to do this, and also the fans, like the feedback I get from everyone is usually super positive. So I always want to make stuff that they enjoy, because I know not everyone can live in LA and do what I do, just like I can't live in different parts of the world and do what they do. So I try and just share a little bit of that with everyone, and just my excitement for StarCraft is never going to dwindle, because it's such a good game. I love watching it, and if I'm going to be watching it, I might as well be making videos anyway. So I think in the future for me, you'll see always more StarCraft. That's never going to be a thing. But also you might start seeing the other people I work with. I mean, again, it's a lot of the top YouTube channels, so you guys already know Total Biscuit, the Yogscast, all the StarCraft guys, of course. But there's a lot of other people I work in the production side who are just crazy awesome. So it's the people I work with, the people who watch my stuff, and the video game itself. I would never slow down. I can't possibly imagine why I would.
Do you have any big plans for the future? Any big pieces of content outside of the Nerd Alerts that you've kind of had as an idea and they're now coming into actual content?
Yeah, we do have the, I like to call it the Super Secret Project on Twitter that we're working with basically everyone. I mean, it involves Total Biscuit, Yogscast, Day9, myself, Ro, Dodger, even my other roommate, Anaris, who doesn't, he has a really small YouTube channel. He doesn't make stuff too much anymore. But it's basically involved with everyone in the game station, and it's going to be an animated series. I think that's public. But it's going to be something that is not StarCraft related, but is very nerdy, and I hope that people like it. It's something that they actually have a full animating staff of like 8 people. They've been working on it for months and months now, and it's something that I'm really excited about. And also, I personally really like new media. I think it's the coolest thing ever, where it's finally, you know, our generation, you don't have to be born into Hollywood. You don't have to go to 10 years of acting school. You don't have to sleep with the producer of your favorite movie. Like, you can make your own content without jumping through a bunch of bullshit hoops. No one likes bullshit hoops. Those are the worst kinds. And, you know, that's what I really like about new media. And StarCraft is actually kind of new media as well, because a random Joe at home can make a StarCraft tournament if he wants to put $100 of his own money on the line, get a couple players. Anyone can do it. Anyone can do that now. And that's what's really exciting for me. And kind of keeps me going.
If YouTube closes tomorrow, where do you go and what do you do?
Well, I mean, like I said, I mean, I have access to a full-on production company. It's like 200 employees or something. I mean, it's a pretty massive company, and it's a full-on production studio. So anything I wanted to do, whether it was make more music videos, whether it was do another animated series about gaming, whether it was anything like that, I would still do that, because there's other websites that you can upload to. I still would like to do live events and things like that, and I'll always find a way to be creating something. So whether it's a website, talking about movies, I don't know. I feel like if you're dedicated enough to something that you're excited about, it's always going to work out. YouTube is definitely not my end-all. It's not the only thing going on in the internet. And maybe I would just upload them all to Twitch and be like, screw it. This is where you got to go to find everything. So I love YouTube. It's a great platform. But if there's a doomsday device that knocks it off the face of the planet, then I'll still be around.
And finally, the question that I always ask as the last question here on Real Talk, define success, and then using that definition for success, do you find yourself to be successful? Another
oh
job
my
interview
God,
question.
JP, what? success is making this company as much money as I can. No, I've always been... I didn't know you asked this question. I'm kind of curious as to what the other guys said, but I've never defined success in any way related to money at all. I mean, you only live once. No, you don't have to say it YOLO, but, you know, seriously,
<don't.
laughs> like, I won't. I know someone's going to edit the video that way, but, you know, I think success is just being happy and surrounding yourself in people that you think are the coolest people ever, and that's something that I have easily done. I mean, I work with people like Day 9. Like, how freaking sweet is that? So I think success is just being happy, and if you are working, so if you're not a trust fund baby or something and you actually have to get a job, enjoying the job as best you can, and then at least having a hobby that you enjoy on the side. Because eventually that hobby may pay off, whether you're doing paintball, dirt biking, I don't know, that can actually pay off in some way. There's a small chance of it, but at least you're enjoying what you're doing. So by that definition, I would say I'm successful. I'm very happy with the people I work with. The supporters I have are just crazy awesome. There's like that hardcore group of 50,000 of them that'll watch every single video that I upload. And those guys I couldn't be more thankful for, because it's other people sharing the same excitement that I have. So everyone out there, like, if you have a terrible job and you hate it, just know, yeah, we all got to put in time in shitty jobs. But also just make sure you find something that you enjoy. And also, just as a life tip, because why not at this point, surround yourself with people that you like and don't deal with people that you can't put up with. And same thing in business. I dumped a lot of companies who wanted to hire me just because I didn't like them. Their attitude was poor. They didn't want to support gaming and stuff the same way I did. So surrounding yourself with people that you love is it's got to make you so happy. Why do you think Day 9 is so goddamn happy all the time? It's because the people he hangs out with he loves, and That I don't know. That's how I define success. So there you go.
There you go, guys. All right, we're going to start taking some questions from the chat. We'll probably do this for 10 or maybe 15 minutes. So if you have a question, just paste it in the chat once. I just realized I was staring at the wrong webcam. This happens when you have three of them pointing at you. But yeah, guys in the chat, feel free to post your question, and we'll get it asked. In the meantime, Husky, what are you doing? What are you doing this week in terms of content? What can people look forward to on your channel?
Let me see. This is my calendar. I have the next Nerd Alert coming out. I always help Ro film her cooking show, which is a completely different demographic than mine, so I wouldn't expect anyone here to be like, oh my
yes.
God, those Adventure Time cupcakes were like really fabulous. So I help her do that a lot. I help Dodger wherever I can. I'm trying to think of content. Mostly I just have, more StarCraft as usual. There is a Husky Tales that's done. I just have to get Total Biscuit's voice, so he's on vacation right now, I think, for a couple of days. So when he's done, that's going to be done relatively soon. But really, I've kind of said this a lot, but I feel like in order for StarCraft to be as popular as I think it should be, I think that there's going to have to be, on everyone's part, there has to be a step up in production, a step up in just basically making the content consumable by more people. And so that's the kind of stuff I really want to work on, like making Nerd Alert an actual band, like going on tour with a band who's actually singing StarCraft songs. Like, to me, that's badass. Like, that's the kind of stuff I can get excited about. And anyone who doesn't agree, I don't care, because I'm in a band singing about StarCraft, so who cares? So anyone, if they are a fan of Nerd Alert, I actually had a meeting with some pretty cool music guru people in the biz. So we actually want to try and make like an album and all that kind
awesome.
Of stuff. So we want to take it super serious while always still casting StarCraft. So keep an eye out for that. But everything moves slow when it comes to producing content, because it's a lot of work. Yes, I know when you watch it on YouTube, it's like a 4-minute video, but the amount of effort it goes in is... I don't know how to even explain it. It's so much work. So we'll see. It's just slow and steady.
Awesome. All right, we got some questions coming in from Zuma. What is Husky's all-time favorite esports moment?
The last game of the HGH Invitational, I think that resonates a lot. Casting the very first MLG that StarCraft was at, yes, I know my casting was atrocious. You guys don't have to keep reminding me of that. But the fact that StarCraft II is finally at a major event like that, I thought was the coolest thing. So... definitely HGH is really good. That's the answer. That's what I'm going to go with.
All right. From Fontel Roy, who is your current favorite player?
Oh man. Now that Kespa players are joining in, I think my answer is going to change very quickly. Jadong was always my favorite player, hands down, because right when I started StarCraft is when he started crushing all the former top players. So I've always been a huge Jadong fanboy, and I have a feeling he's going to be my favorite player just based on the playstyle we've seen from him so far. But right now, I mean, I still love the kind of the old dogs like White Raw, TLO, and all them. But also, I mean, at IEM right now, I haven't checked the most updated things, but like Vortex, for example, is playing really well. So really any player who says, you know what, I'm going to be as good as the Koreans and I'm going to do well in tournaments, I always enjoy following them. So I want to say White Rod TLO, but Jadong's sneaking up, guys. So maybe he'll be my favorite player soon.
Also, he wants to know, pizza or cheeseburger?
Pizza, man. Pizza is by far my favorite food. And before everyone in the chat's like, what a bleh, I worked at a place called Burgerville for 3 years, and I ate like 10 burgers every day because their food is absolutely delicious. So I like pizza. If I worked at a pizza place for 3 years, I probably would say hamburgers, though.
All right. We got a long question here from...
Ooh, let's hear it.
I can't even say his name. Herrapper2. Multiple questions here. Do you think you will get as many views for Heart of the Swarm as for Wings of Liberty? Or do you think that your early viewers have either stopped watching StarCraft or are watching something else like Twitch?
More towards the later half where... Honestly, a lot of the people who watched when StarCraft II just came out, they were the people who were not watching Brood War. They were the people who just played Brood War casually, and then when StarCraft II came out, they watched it for a little while. So a lot of those people, I mean, to be quite frank, I've talked to probably thousands of people. A lot of them do indeed just don't watch stuff online as much anymore. But with Heart of the Swarm, I think there's going to be as much views, but is it going to be specifically on my videos? Probably not, because when StarCraft II just came out, I mean, let's be honest, there was not a whole lot of content out there to consume, and now you get awesome tournaments almost every single weekend, you get hundreds of YouTube channels, you get a resource like Team Liquid, which has grown immensely since the release of StarCraft II. So as a fan going into StarCraft II, like, there is just so much more stuff to watch that I think the views are still there. They're just definitely, I wouldn't call it diluted. A lot of people like to use the term diluted. I think that, yes, big events get less views, but a lot of people are still watching StarCraft. Like, so many people are still watching StarCraft, especially like in colleges and stuff. People send me pictures of their barcrafts and things like that all the time. So will my videos get 400,000 views like they used to? Probably not. But a lot of the higher quality stuff that I make still does well, and that's what I'm most excited about. Because for me, it's not about how many views are my StarCraft videos getting. It's more about like how many people are watching the sport as a whole. And so I would hope that they would start watching a lot more of those big events and stuff come Heart of the Swarm. We're going to have to see, but I firmly believe that the social aspect is, if Blizzard can bring all the people back who have taken a break from StarCraft II and present them with a social platform to actually engage and have a reason to log back into the game, because right now the only reason to log in is to play. If they can add that social side to it, then those people are going to stay around a lot longer, especially if Blizzard starts promoting tournaments more within the client, which is something that they do. Uh-huh. They're starting to do a lot more now. They redesigned Battle.net, and it's a lot better as far as advertising tournaments. I think that those are the important things. And let's have to wait and see. But long story short, my videos probably won't ever have as many views as they did, but that's because there's so much cool stuff out there to watch.
All right, four more questions for you, then we'll wrap this up and call it a
show.
Let's
do it.
From Pingu242, Husky, since you solo cast so much, is there an adjustment to working with a partner at tournaments, or was it just natural?
It is not natural at all, man. It is tough. It's about as unnatural as me if you ever see me with tan skin, because it is so tough to cast with people that it is its own beast. Now, there's some casters who may be easier to cast with than others just because I watch more of their stuff, but solo casting is completely different, because solo casting, you're just like, how can I entertain people for 30 plus minutes? Whereas with solo or with a duo casting, it's more like, how can I interact with my other caster to really add something that a solo cast can't do? So it takes a lot of practice, and honestly, the only way to practice that was to do it, because casting at a live event, like, They see you. You're on camera, so you can't even have any weird like body language. You have to focus on so many different things that you never have to think about before. So I'm super confident solo casting. I can dual cast, I think, very well with Artosis, Day9, and Apollo. But, you know, there are some other casters out there that we have to talk a little bit before the game and be like, okay, let's make sure we vibe well and try and figure out what style works for us. Because, like, you know, the way I cast with Mr. Bitter is going to be completely different than the way I cast with Total Biscuit. And that's one thing that I really try and do is adapt my casting style to lift up and support the other caster as much as I can. So it was tough, but I'm very confident in my abilities to do it now. But if there's ever an awkward moment, like when I'm dual casting with someone, I mean, it just happens. Like, it's just how it goes, because you're trying to say a million things while also not ignoring the handsome nerd next to you. So it's tough, but with a lot of practice, anybody can do it, man.
From Bootstraps, his question is, in the spirit of real talk, can you explain what happened between you and Lag TV and how your relationship has progressed, if it has at all?
So I think the whole Lag TV thing is one of those things where everyone knows more than I do about it. Because I think what I remember from a couple of years ago is that they used to spam my channel a lot. And, like, I'm totally over it. I don't care. But what I do is anytime anyone spams anything on my channel at all, especially links to off of my channel, because God knows what they're linking to, I just straight up ban them, because I want the chat to be not... You're not watching the video to advertise your own video. You're watching the video because you want to watch StarCraft. And so in my bans list, I probably have like 5,000 people banned. Like, I honestly, if people are linking to off website, or if they're advertising something else, like the chat, the comments there on my page are for talking about the game. I just ban anyone who does that, because I didn't used to do that. And it was literally so bad that like on the first 20 comments, 10 to 15 of them would be advertising something else, whether it's another channel, whether it's a video, whether it's a website. So I just like hunkered down and locked it down. So theirs was one of the ones that I banned. I don't even read the names when I banned them. And then apparently, like, they wanted me to unban them. I'm trying to remember, because this was so long ago, and I think I unbanned them, but maybe I didn't. And then there was something about how they can't post comments now, and I'm like, I don't know what's going on. And I've heard, I don't even know, like, what is. Like, people are always like, why do you hate Lag TV? And I'm like, I don't know what we're talking about. Like, I feel like people actually know more about it than I do. So if I have somehow offended Lag TV, if they for some reason are mad at me, I apologize. I will say that posting comments on my channel is not that great of a privilege, I guess. Just make a Lag TV 2. I don't know. So if they're mad at me, I apologize. There's no beef there. Do they talk about? Do we know? Is there still drama?
I have never heard of this drama. So
okay, no, it's something that I see pop up like once every month, and so there's those diehard Lag TV fans who are like, "You have offended their honor, so we are going to ask you until you answer it 20 times." So I don't know. I don't hate them. I'm such a nice guy. Like, I don't hate people. We need to stop with the Husky hates people.
Let's just move on with the next question from Canthos. With how the Caspa players have been playing in the WCS, how do you think the current GOM TV players will be doing in 6 months to a year?
You know, it's... I think most people say, from what I've seen, most people say that they will be about as good as players are now in 6 months. And... oh, excuse me, sorry. I still believe, and I don't know if this is because I'm completely biased, I still believe that they're going to absolutely crush the competition, and I feel like the StarCraft 2 players right now have got to be really careful, because, you know, a lot of the top players right now were B-teamers from StarCraft 1, and you may say, well, they have a big jump start. They have 2 years on those players. You got to remember that the players from Brood War were the best because they had the right training regimen, they had the right idea, they had the right mindset and ideas when it comes to how a competitive game should play out. So even though I think this goes against what most people think, and maybe a lot of people will disagree with me, I firmly think that some of those Kessel players are going to be the best players we've ever seen. It's not necessarily based on their play from the WCS. I actually haven't been able to watch the WCS, which I'm really upset about, because a lot of people are posting about, like, oh my god, this crazy maneuver by Jadon got him, blah, blah, blah. I read the post, but I haven't seen a lot of the games. I think they're going to be the best players out there. That's not to say that, like, MC and Stefano won't be at the top of their game still, but I would watch out for them, because players like Flash and Bisou and Stork, they're gonna practice like I don't think we've seen any player do yet. So I think that they're going to be the best, but I've seen a lot of posts that disagree.
From Seriously, Husky, what is your favorite tournament to cast for?
like live tournaments.
I guess so, yeah.
I want to say my favorite online tournament is the TSL, just because they do so few tournaments, and I just remember the old school Brood War a couple of tournaments that they did. So I always love casting for the TSL. Uh-huh. Live events, I really like doing the Red Bull event, just because they tried to do something different, like I said. And also MLG at the Anaheim Convention Center. For some reason, I just like when it's at the Anaheim Convention Center, because it always reminds me of like BlizzCon and like just how awesome esports is. So I would say MLG at Anaheim, and the one Red Bull event I did with Day 9 was amazing. So I hope there's more of that going on.
All right, final question once again from Harapper2. Yeah, if you were a player, what race would you play in Heart of the Storm, and what would you use from your casting experience to help you as a player? Sorry, reading's tough.
Well, I mean, yelling a lot doesn't really help out while playing. So maybe I would also host the event. I don't know. If I was a professional player, I mean, I'm best with Protoss right now, which is still only like low diamond, so it's not like I'm that great. So I would probably start as Protoss. With Heart of the Swarm, I really like. Like, a lot of people are complaining about the Terran edition of units, but I actually really like what they're doing with Terran. They're giving them more zoning control with the mines that they have, and adding more units that are going to fill different roles. So if I had to straight up be Master League at any race, I'd probably pick Terran, just because I like the versatility. I feel like Terran is a complete race, whereas what they're doing with Protoss makes it feel more gimmicky, when I already kind of feel like Protoss is a little gimmicky, because they're adding units that, instead of like have an attack, they lock down your minerals. And so for me, I don't like that kind of like, I'm denying you from mining. I don't like being that guy. So I would prefer to have lots of different attacking units that all fill different roles. And I think that's what they're kind of doing with Terran. So I'm most excited to see what happens with Terran. But I think maybe being a caster, I could definitely learn the importance of keeping up to date on every single tournament. Definitely practicing for specific players. Like if I was in a tournament and it had brackets, for example, I mean, you can definitely see trends. Like MC, for example, right now, the last 6 or 7 games I've watched of his, he's always gotten double forge at a very specific time. So that's something that you would need to know going into that matchup. I think a lot of players do that, but definitely not all of them. And I don't know. I guess I'd play Terran, but I still love Protoss. No matter what Blizzard does to Protoss, they could make them a Zealot-only race, I would still love them. So go Protoss.
And finally, I think the best way to end the show is someone subscribe just to say, thank you, Husky. You're the reason that I'm watching TSL and IEM right now. So there you go, Husky. Mike,
yeah.
You got any shout-outs? Where can people check out your stuff if they're not already, which is kind of silly?
I mean, most people know my main channel, Husky StarCraft. My second channel is more for casual games. So if there's one of you out there who likes games other than StarCraft, that's where I upload my more casual stuff. It's just Husky on YouTube, so it's Husky. But that's a super casual channel. I don't take it that serious. I just have fun on it. But I definitely have to give a big thanks to, of course, anyone who watches StarCraft as a whole, because you guys are what are making esports what it is today. And also anyone who watches my stuff, especially, I feel like I have that core of like 50,000 who seem to show up in every single video. So thank you, everyone, who supports my stuff. Even if you don't watch my stuff anymore, I do read a lot of the posts online. So if you're talking about me on Reddit or Team Liquid, I'm most likely seeing it. I'm definitely giggling at it if it's a rage-filled hate comment for no reason. I actually
don't tell people
it.
That you're reading that. Come on,
dude. I actually have a rule where I only mostly reply to comments. It's like a 90. I think I have a 9-to-1 ratio rule where I reply to nine nice comments and then one bad comment. So if you wanna get a reply from me, then being nice. So a big shout out to the nice people in the world, because I feel like the haters get all the credit. But everyone who supports esports, you can follow me. I guess just Husky on YouTube is my second channel, and thank you, JP, for having me and preparing me for my next big job interview.
There you go. Thank you for coming on, Mike. Thanks also for all the help with YouTube and stuff. For those of you who don't know, Mike's been really, really helping me on that front, as well as TGS. They're a great company. But wrapping everything up, guys, I think the subscriber-only chat went well. I'll probably ask a bunch of the subscribers afterwards, but it looks like it did well. I also want to mention the Artosis episode was supposed to happen, but Naniwa wanted to come on, and when Naniwa asked to come on Real Talk, you don't really say no, guys. So Artosis is still planned to occur. It'll probably be after MLG Raleigh next weekend, as long as he's not going to Australia or some other crazy place. That guy travels almost every weekend, so it's really, really hard to dial down and get on a Real Talk. But it's still happening. We've also got Carmack planned. Still wanting to do Justin Wong. Still wanting to do a bunch of players, as well as doing some League of Legends guys as well. And remember to subscribe to me here on YouTube, on Twitch, on Twitter, and on Facebook. It's all /itmejp. And if you want to help support me, you can subscribe here on Twitch. I will also say that we're going to try to do 3 to 4 Real Talks each month, so you're not just paying $5 for one kind of round of questions for whoever's going to be on Real Talk. I'm going to try to plan it out so you know the 4 guests for that month, so if you don't want to subscribe, then you don't have to. I'll try to be as transparent as possible with that. But like I said, if that's how you want to support me, please do. Other than that, that is going to do it for Real Talk. Thank you again, Mike Husky Lamont, for coming on. Go check out his StarCraft channel over at Husky StarCraft on YouTube if you don't already. But that'll do it, guys. We will see you next time on Real Talk. I'm JP McDaniel, signing out.